Today's video is sponsored by SimpliSafe. 2021 is almost over, and with the release of Pokemon Brilliant Diamond and Shining Pearl having come out just last week, the majority of really big Nintendo Switch games have come out for this year. But looking ahead to 2022, the lineup looks absolutely incredible, and that's just the stuff we know of right now. So much so that honestly, depending on how many of them actually deliver, it might end up being the strongest year in the system's library. Now, part of the reason for this is because some of these games were maybe supposed to come out this year and got delayed, but the point is, there's a lot of great stuff coming out on the way, so much so that as I was making this list, I just felt myself getting more and more hype just thinking about it. So I wanted to go over some of the games that I'm really excited for next year. Some of these I think are really obvious, you guys don't really need me to hype them up for you, so I'm just gonna kind of speed through those ones really quick. And after that, I'm gonna kind of slow down a little bit and shine some light on some smaller titles that if you guys haven't heard of them yet or just haven't really looked into what they are yet, I think there's some ones really worth getting excited about. So first off, let's just kind of speed through some of the obvious ones, huh? At the start of next year, we're gonna get Pokemon Legends Arceus. For a long time, we've been hoping to get some kind of home console, bigger evolution version of the regular Pokemon formula, and this is the first really major attempt at that. Whether or not it actually succeeds in capturing these hopes and dreams, we'll find out, but at least for now, for the time being, just exciting that it is happening and happening soon. Splatoon 3 is coming out, which is, to be honest, not the game that I'm personally the most excited for, but I know that there's a lot of people that cannot wait to play this game. I do really appreciate that while I'm personally not super huge into focused multiplayer competitive games, I enjoyed the single player mode that Splatoon 2 added. I'll probably try the one that's added in Splatoon 3 as well. And while it's not really my cup of tea, I do really appreciate the different direction the Splatoon 3 takes with the third person shooter formula. The Kirby franchise is undergoing a massive change next year with Kirby and the Forgotten Land. This is the first game in the series to be a 3D platformer that looks, at least based on the trailers, to be taking a lot of cues from Super Mario Odyssey, which I am all for. Also, it takes place in what looks like a post-apocalyptic civilization, almost like Nier. Probably not quite that sad or emotional, but still looks really interesting to me. Bayonetta 3 is slated to finally come out after having been first revealed during the Switch's first year back in 2017. We've been waiting on news for this one a long time. And if you're a fan at all of beautiful, frantic, fast-paced action games, the things that Platinum is known for, definitely one you don't want to miss out on. And then there's, of course, the untitled sequel to The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, which, do I really need to explain why that's something to be excited for? It's finally happening. Hopefully, unless it gets pushed back again. Whatever, it'll be worth the wait. So those are like the really obvious first, second party, exclusive kind of ones that I think a lot of people already know about. Let's talk about some other ones that I cannot wait to play. In some cases, even more so than the games we just talked about. And first off, right off the bat, I want to talk about Triangle Strategy. If you follow me on Twitter, you'll know that this is the game that I have talked constantly about being my most anticipated game of next year. It's actually tied with another game that's also on this list, and we'll talk about in a moment. But Triangle Strategy is a new game coming from Square Enix, specifically coming from Team Asano, the same dev team that made Octopath Traveler. Obviously, you can see that kind of visual influence there, but instead of being a more traditional turn-based RPG, Triangle Strategy is pulling more from Square Enix's history with tactical RPGs. Final Fantasy Tactics is probably the game that I think most people would be familiar with this formula, along with its sequels on the Game Boy Advance and DS. Although a specific game this looks like this is pulling even more from is one of my old personal favorites, Tactics Ogre. This style of RPG focuses a lot on tactical knowledge, placement of units, all that kind of good stuff, but something else going on at the same time that happened back in Tactics Ogre is also narrative branching with decisions. They did release a demo of the game that actually showcased one of these moments where you got to make a choice and see what happens afterwards in the story. And at least based on that little snippet we saw in the demo, it branches really heavily, going to two very different battles with a lot of different context and things happening in the overarching story. And I absolutely eat this kind of stuff up. I have been waiting for a new tactics game like this ever since the last Tactics Ogre, which was a remake on PSP that dropped in 2010. So it's been a little over a decade, a bit of a wait. And while there have been some great fan love letters that I think tap into this genre a little bit, I'm really excited to see Square Enix take another try at it. Next up, let's talk about not one, but two games actually coming from the same developer, Dotemu. Now, if you're not familiar with who that developer is, they're responsible for making, or at least producing, a number of retro love letter style indie games, as well as official sequels to some games, one of the most recent big hits being the newer Streets of Rage, which was an incredible side-scrolling beat-em-up. And one of their upcoming titles that they are producing in 2022 is another beat-em-up with Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Shredder's Revenge. If you grew up with the beat-em-up genre, there are a lot of great classic franchises to celebrate, but if you're talking about ones connected to licensed IPs, the TMNT games, especially Turtles in Time, were some of the best beat-em-ups of their era. And the goal of Shredder's Revenge looks to be to revive that same feeling, that same look, that same style, but still adapt and update it with more modern gaming conventions, similar to what Dotemu did with Streets of Rage. Along with the main cast of the traditional lead four Ninja Turtles, they've also revealed that April O'Neil will be a playable character, and I get the feeling that's not where the list is gonna end. If you look at some of the promotional materials, it definitely looks like there's a lot of space to add more characters, kind of like what Nintendo was doing with the Super Smash Bros. Mural. So I'm very excited to see what final form this game takes, because based on the initial trailers, this is gonna be another great addition to modern day beat-em-ups. Now, as for something that Dotemu themselves are actually directly working on, we're also getting a new game in the Metal Slug franchise, but instead of being the side-scrolling arcade shoot-em-up like they usually are, this one is taking a cue from one of my favorite genres, which we've already touched on a little bit, tactics games. Metal Slug Tactics emulates the visual style of these side-scrolling shooters, but takes them into a different genre. That honestly, that's about all we really know about this game for sure. We've just gotten a few different hype trailers back to back that do show snippets of gameplay, but not enough to fully contextualize everything we're seeing. You can get just the littlest inkling about what kind of RPG mechanics are gonna be featured as part of this game. But based on what we're seeing in the trailers alone, along with Dotemu's history of success, I've got high hopes for this one. Now, before we move on to the next set of games, I do want to take a moment to thank SimpliSafe for sponsoring today's video. If you've been looking to make your home or office more safe, there's never been a time than right now, because SimpliSafe is giving early access to their Black Friday deals, where you can save 50% or more on their award-winning home security. SimpliSafe offers an easy and affordable way to help protect your home or office with a security package that you can customize to fit your own needs. You can pick and choose what sensors and devices you need that are all connected to a 24/7 monitoring service that can send help quick right in an emergency when you need it. For me personally, I was looking at redoing the security around our office, because while we are in a pretty safe area, that doesn't mean that things can't happen. And in fact, I know for sure that we have had break-in attempts. And in fact, one person even succeeded at breaking in, but for some reason, the only thing they tried to steal was our router. Not really sure what the end goal was there, but the point is, things happen and it pays off to be prepared. All of SimpliSafe's devices were super easy to install, didn't require tools or anything, and now we have a motion sensor that can have activated while not in the office, a glass break sensor that listens for the exact frequency of glass breaking if someone tries to get in through a window, and even an indoor camera that I can check the feed of by using the SimpliSafe app on my phone. Speaking of cameras, they've also launched a new outdoor camera that offers an ultra-wide 140-degree field of view, 1080p resolution, 8x zoom, and a built-in spotlight with color night vision, giving you a clear look of what's going on outside. It even makes use of a replaceable chargeable battery, so you can set it up anywhere, you don't have to worry where there is an outlet. Again, they are doing a massive Black Friday sale right now, where you can save 50% or more on a SimpliSafe security system designed just for your own needs. Visit simplisafe.com/KevinKenson to learn more. Dotemu is not the only smaller team that's been really killing it when it comes to retro love letter games. Another dev team that I really love is Inti Creates. Now, most recently, they're probably known for the Bloodstained Curse of the Moon games, which are very old school Castlevania vibe. But before that, their really big major franchise is Azure Striker Gunvolt, which is getting its third entry in 2022. Now, part of what makes this franchise really cool is that it's effectively unofficially Mega Man. Inti Creates is actually the team that was responsible for a lot of the later Mega Man games that were released on Nintendo handhelds, like the Mega Man Zero franchise on GBA and ZX games on DS. And while obviously any kind of major identifiers of that franchise have been cleaned off of Gunvolt, the gameplay is very much a continuation of that style. What's really cool about these games too is how it balances the gameplay of old school Mega Man games by also presenting a way to make it a little more challenging for people that want to push themselves more. Basically, you can take your time and carefully shoot your way through a lot of the stages and have relatively minimal difficulty in doing so, but there's a scoring system that heavily rewards getting through things as quickly as you can, not just in terms of time trial, but also in terms of the consistency of defeating enemies and just breaking through them as fast as you can. It adds a healthy amount of replayability to where you can do one playthrough just to kind of get familiar with the stages, the enemies, the bosses, and all that good stuff, and then tackle it again with as much skill as you can bring. If you're a fan at all of old school side-scrolling platformers, this is a series to keep your eye on. Going back to some larger companies real quick, there's a couple titles that, yes, they are coming from big name companies, but I don't think people are necessarily giving them as much attention. The first of which I want to talk about is going back to Square Enix with Chocobo GP. It is no secret that Mario Kart 8 Deluxe is the top selling Switch game, just overall, flat out, partially due to bundles, but also because it's a really good game. So much so that a lot of people have been really hoping for them to maybe announce some kind of new racing game soon. And based on Nintendo's history, it's not really clear unclear if that's really going to happen. So here comes Square Enix stepping in with a surprise relaunch of a franchise we haven't seen in a little while, Chocobo Racing with Chocobo GP. Now, while the title has Chocobo in it, honestly, this looks like it's more or less just a spin-off of the Final Fantasy franchise in total, offering, of course, Chocobo characters as playable racers, but also characters from major Final Fantasy releases like Vivi from Final Fantasy IX. The trailers we've seen so far show that this game is wearing its Mario Kart inspirations on its sleeve. It is not being shy about it at all, and to be honest, I'm all for it. I enjoy Mario Kart 8, I still like playing it today, but I'm completely down to try something new that plays in a similar vein. So if Nintendo's not gonna do it anytime soon, I am more than happy to see one of my favorite older franchises put their own spin on it. Next year, we're also getting a sequel to what is probably one of the most surprising crossover games ever, Mario plus Rabbids. Now, to be honest, I don't really care about Rabbids. I never really found them to be that funny or entertaining, but the original Mario plus Rabbids was a very pleasantly surprising tactical XCOM style game featuring Mario and Rabbid characters. On paper, it's honestly not at all the kind of thing I expected to really enjoy or get excited about, but after playing the first one, I very much want more of it, and I'm excited to see a newer, possibly bigger, more expanded version of it come out next year. Man, I've been talking about a lot of tactics games. That's a good feeling. All right, let's get indie again with my other top anticipated game of next year. Triangle Strategy ties with it, and they're both just games I really cannot wait to get my hands on. Sea of Stars. This is a crowdfunded game that is not exclusive to the Nintendo Switch, but honestly, it feels like it would be most at home on a Nintendo platform. Full disclosure, I did put some of my own money into kickstarting this game, and it's from the same devs behind The Messenger, which was an excellent retro-style platformer inspired by ninja platformers like Ninja Gaiden. Sea of Stars is them approaching a new genre, however, by making their own love letter to SNES-era JRPGs. They have listed a few of their particular inspirations, including Super Mario RPG, Illusions of Gaia, but by far, the very obvious main one is Chrono Trigger, my personal favorite game of all time. The art style and battle system that we've seen so far very clearly shows this inspiration, and while other games have touched on this inspiration before, the execution and quality of The Messenger being brought over to this game and just what we've been seeing so far and the little tidbits they've been sharing here and there really looks like it might be one of the games to really deliver on bringing back that feeling and style that those late 90s RPGs had. Which, by the way, they have had a campaign going on where they've been sharing more and more about the game based on how many people follow them on Twitter and interact with social posts. So if any of this game sounds interesting to you, please go check out their Twitter, follow it if you have an account, because I would love to see more of those updates happen. Obviously, given my taste in games, there's been a lot of retro love letters here, especially to games from the sort of 2D 16-bit era, but one other retro love letter that goes a little later in time is Bomb Rush Cyberpunk, which if you're at all familiar with its source inspiration, you can tell right away that this is meant to be a spiritual successor to Jet Set Radio. So much so that not only is it borrowing a lot of the style and energy behind it, but it also features a soundtrack including songs from the same composer. And based on the tracks we've heard so far in the trailers, it absolutely hits just as hard. If you've been waiting for something, anything to scratch that Jet Set Radio itch, this looks like it might be the game to finally do it. Now, there are so many other games coming out next year that I'm excited about. Some of them I didn't talk about because they already came up in a previous video I made earlier this year talking about games I'm excited for in 2021 that ended up getting pushed back to 2022. So check out that video if you happen to see a couple other games worth getting excited about. Something else worth noting is that these, again, are just the games we know about. There are a number of games that we know about that just have kind of had unclear release dates that might end up dropping next year as well. I am still holding out for that information on Hollow Knight Silksong. Metroid Prime 4 is, of course, also on the way eventually, although the release of Metroid Dread might have reset that timer a little bit, so we're gonna keep waiting on that one. And then, of course, there's games that just might not have been announced at all that we could learn about. A couple different first and second party devs for Nintendo have been pretty quiet since their last releases. Fire Emblem Three Houses, they did DLC for that came out later, and we haven't heard a word since. And Fire Emblem is a pretty big franchise they try to maintain having more releases for. So the timing might be about right for a new one to get revealed and released, if not next year, sometime not too long after. And while we're talking RPGs, Xenoblade Chronicles also had a lot of success with Chronicles 2 on the Switch near its launch. We got a remake of the original game launched on the Switch as well, and so it might be about that time to either finally port over Xenoblade Chronicles X or maybe reveal and release Chronicles 3. And who knows? knows? Even though I'm extremely skeptical about it, Nintendo might even surprise us by doing another Mario Kart on the Switch, although based on how well 8 Deluxe keeps selling, I don't see that happening. The point is, there is already an incredible lineup of games we already know about for the Switch coming out next year, and there is plenty of time for us to find out even more. So those are some of the games I am most excited for coming to the Switch next year. Let me know down below in the comments what you think. What games are you excited for? What ones did I leave out that you just cannot wait to get your hands on? As always, if you enjoyed the video, like it, subscribe if you haven't, and I'll see you guys later.